Hello, everybody, and welcome to the commentary for Four Eyes, my third short film that I made. This is a film that I wrote when I was 18 years old, probably 2008, 2009. I concepted the film. It was about three pages. In 2015, as I met my friends Kalani Hubbard and Dustin Ward, we were talking about projects that we wanted to make, and we wanted to make a short film, and I pitched the idea of Four Eyes, which then I began a rewrite on it, which is the film you are going to see today. If you haven't already seen it, I suggest you go see that and not watch the commentary. This is for people who want to get some more insight on the film that came out in 2017, shot in 2016, starring Matt Donovan, Callie Weeks, Ty King, Jodi Oak, and a couple other folks, and it's going to be a fun time. So if you want some behind the scenes details, you can check this out. And I'm also going to be releasing a behind the scenes video, which will have some outtakes, some more behind the scenes sort of things, and stuff like that. So check that out on another upload that I'm going to be uploading to this channel here maybe in a few days. So let's get underway with the film Four Eyes.
Hi, Darren. It's Dr. Delphin giving you a call again. I haven't heard from you in quite some time.
So this beginning scene here is something interesting I thought of in the screenplay, which was I wanted to open with a very very tough scene. It's a man puking up his guts, and you see a pill bottle there, giving the implication to the audience that the man is suicidal or attempting to commit suicide. In the one of the drafts of the script, it was actually darker than this. But I ended up taking that back because of it just being a really sensitive topic. But anyways, this shot was much longer, and you may see it in the next video upload where you'll see actually how long the scene was before I ended up cutting it up. This is in New York City. If you don't know, this film shot in New York and Lubbock, Texas, Post, Texas, Dickens, Texas, and Plainview, Texas. And mostly every time that you see scenes that look like it's New York, it's New York. But there is a lot of stuff that we faked in Lubbock and other parts of Texas. And I'll point those out as we come along. This right here, there's a lot of visual effects in this scene. I wish I could have pointed them out, like the reflection in his glasses, the train coming down the thing that Dustin Ward actually put together. And it looks incredible. That dude is a wizard. All this was really tough to actually shoot. Honestly, it was really chaotic, and it was tough to direct a scene. These scenes, I feel like, this was actually a pickup we did in like 2017, before the film came out, the outside exterior shot. There is James Aaron Tyler. He's an awesome actor that I've worked with on Ben, I Like You and some projects that actually never came out, but he's an awesome, awesome dude from Lubbock as well.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, if you want...
This scene here, this location here is actually in Plainview, Texas. My mom right was working at this company here, and we were able to get in there at like 8 p.m. and we shot till like 5 a.m., I think. It was quite late. But it was a lot different in the script. It was more of like a cubicle scenario, and... when I was just desperate for a location, so you know, this ended up working just as well. So this beat in the script about the pictures was a much bigger moment, which you'll see play out in the film later, but so interesting how it is. It's funny, this scene here was probably shot at like 5 a.m. in the morning, and we were just, you know, we had started like early that day, and gosh, making films is tough, people. And that's a beautiful shot. Kalani Hubbard actually shot that And that was an insert shot we got later on. This is actually in Post, Texas, in a coffee shop slash theater that one of my family members' mother's place. Really cool spot. That's Dustin Ward's old apartment, our cinematographer. And this is as well, obviously. Man, it's crazy to look back at this stuff. I'm currently releasing my fourth short film, Just Like the Butterfly. It's coming out pretty soon, and it's just pretty cool to look back at this stuff. This is Max, who's actually in Just Like the Butterfly. He is in that black and white short film we shot, and he did a great job there, and did an incredible job in the fourth short film that's coming out.
Yeah, that's good thinking, Frank.
I love this scene, and it's tough. It's tough to do this because you're taking a huge leap here of faith to actually follow this. You know, a character is desperate to end his own life, and he gets inspiration from a film. I mean, it's definitely possible. That scene that of him on the computer was supposed to be this big like thing where he's searching on the dark web of looking for how he's gonna do this, and it just ended up getting, you know, sliced up. This is actually Lubbock, Texas here. If any of you've been downtown Lubbock, that's pretty obvious. But we wanted the alleyway in New York, and we actually were not gonna find an alleyway. There's actually not much alleyways, and at least from what I've seen, they're all like kind of gated off from what I've seen in New York. Man, this was a challenging day of filming. Our actor here, not Matt, but our other actor here had to get home. It was quite late, and he had to get home and get ready for, you know, to sleep so he can be at work the next morning. And we kept him out a little too late. And so it was tough. We had to do a bunch of reworking of the script to get this scene figured out, to get him in and out. Like, what are all the important things that we need to showcase here? Is it, you know, like when you're making a script, there's maybe just a lot of stuff that's more comedic or, you know, just filler dialogue. We had to actually pull all that out of the scene to get to the point of the scene, which is get, what are we trying to do here? And it actually makes the scene better. I feel like there was just more, you know, there was like a homeless man in the alleyway at a certain point where the lead character, Darren, talks to, and it's just all this garbage that's kind of around it. And us being put in this pressure cooker to get our actor, you know, getting him able to leave this day, we had to really do it. Here's a really, really cool scene for a director to pull off, which is this one take, one shot of all these extras and friends in this scene. And this was really fun to do. And you'll check out the behind the scenes video I'm creating. You'll see how many takes we did and where we ended up finding the perfect shot for this scene. And it's just really cool how it turned out. And it's different, obviously. Most of the things in this film is different from how it is in the script, but it's the way it did turn out is awesome. And this was just tough. This is just tough stuff to pull. I'm looking at this thing going, man, we had to do a lot. And here's one of the coolest scenes of the film. I feel like Jodi Oak right there, and Jared Brandon and Yogi Calhoun, I mean, they just look at tough. And here's another scene that ended up getting pulled back in the edit as well. This, there was more between Yogi and Jared and Jody all talking back and forth, and it was quite funny. But whenever I was testing the film with folks, they thought it was funny, but they just felt like it pulled away from the impact of what the scene was.
I mean, I couldn't find anything about you.
You know, whenever you're crafting a film, that's you kind of gotta focus on creating the movie perfectly in tone, and that's kind of a tough thing whenever you love certain things. Like I loved what Jared did and what Yogi was doing, but it just didn't make sense for the whole piece. So you kind of got to lose things like that. What and did you need from me, Dan? But you'll see it in the behind the scenes piece that I'm releasing. You'll see this really funny exchange between Jared and Yogi, and it's quite enjoyable. And I'm glad I just thought I was like, you know, I should release that because it's quite funny.
Fill this out.
This is also like a part of like the thing I was talking about earlier is, you know, filling out an application. It's kind of mixed between funny and weird. It's like, you know, like he got the inspiration to hire Hitman from a television show or a movie or whatever it was, and then now he's filling out an application to hire Hitman. I think in the script this film was more outside the realm of reality. It was more like a Her kind of film, like the film Her, if you've ever seen it with Joaquin Phoenix. It's just not in reality, or Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. Like, it's still in reality, but there's certain aspects of the world that are a little sci-fi or a little, you know, otherworldly. And I think I originally wanted the film to be more like that, but, you know, it's just me being a director or a writer who's learning and growing. I didn't really know how to express that or even achieve that. And so the film got more grounded, I think, as the film started getting made. So it would be really cool to tackle this in a feature film and actually tackle the tone of this reality, but then having this sci-fi or otherworldly aspect to it, I think would be a very interesting approach. Jody in this scene is just, he's so a big cool thing about this film is he auditioned for the film, and the original intent of the scene, like I was saying, like this other reality, was supposed to be kind of like an Agent Smith, like a white room. He gets, you know, knocked in the back of the head in an elevator and wakes up in this white room, and it's almost like, whoa, who's he sitting in front of? The devil? What is it? But when Jody auditioned, it kind of grounded the movie in this kind of different reality, and I was like, oh, this is a really, he had a great audition. So, man, he's killing it here. He absolutely changed the film for the better, I think. And he did a fantastic job in this movie. This is there was actually a scene in the script that led with him getting dumped out of a car in the street. And I thought it was such a cool, would have been a cool scene, but we didn't have to cut it for time. We never actually filmed it. Like, we just, whenever I was scheduled the movie, it was just like, there's just no way. Hey, and there's me doing some busking, you know, a little cameo. I actually didn't cameo in my, I've cameoed in all my films except for Just Like the Butterfly. I didn't even think of cameoing in that. Kind of funny. Now we're back here. Here's Ty King killing it. He has one of the best lines in the film, which he improvised, but I'll take credit for it. He improvised the line that's coming up about Starburst, and it's kind of cool because it connects back to what Aaron says at the beginning of the film, which is he says there's Starburst in the drawer, and and then I can't remember how those things connect. It's been so long, but I don't think it was really talked about. It just kind of happened. Great scene though. Matt Donovan told me ahead of time that he had something special for this scene, and because what he ends up doing where he goes up and gets in the boss's face was not in the script. So his approach, he was telling me, like, hey, I got a cool idea for this scene, man. We were all just laughing. You'll see it in the behind the scenes, but we were all just on the floor just like, man, that was so funny with Ty's Starburst line and what Matt ends up doing. It just perfectly, it's a perfect scene, and it's sort of the tone of the movie in which I originally was approaching, which is a comedy drama. And I think we kind of end up landing more in I think it still is a comedy drama, but we kind of are darker than I was originally intending. But whatever, making a film is all about just figuring out, you know, how to do it. You know, you're kind of building the plane in the air.
I like you, Derek. I hate you.
He doesn't mean that.
This was pretty tough to do. It was tough, like, scene to achieve. I mean, he has the jacket on now. Like, I had to figure that out because we shot these scenes so out of order. And Matt had the jacket on for this one and didn't have, like, so I had to hold on to a shot longer to be like, okay, maybe put the jacket on. It's like, it still works. But I remember in the edit, I remember thinking like, oh my goodness, we screwed that up. And, yeah, that's really funny where he held that stapler in the air.
Fired or did you quit?
And there's Callie Weeks. Yeah. This little cute scene here. And her necklace is tucked inside of her dress there. I don't think we really achieved and I feel like I keep saying that, bashing on this movie, my own movie. But I think it's, you know, you learn and you grow. But I feel like in the script, it was especially in the original parts of the film, it was really big emphasis on this girl he liked and he was staring at. But, you know, kind of got pulled out of the film. You know, you see him say, you know, I throw faith and love out the window, and he looks at her. But I just don't think it was like this. In the script, it was much bigger emphasis on looking across the room and seeing this this woman there. So this is the whole, like, fun part of the movie where you're seeing a man kind of, he knows it's the end, and he's just going to... he's just going to, you know, give no F's about nothing. You know, he's just going to eat his hot dog in the park, go to the movies by himself, spend all his cash, and just say goodbye. And he's going to enjoy life. And, you know, that's a... It's kind of a cool thing to know it's the end and not really just care. I think everyone kind of wishes they could just... you know, quit their job and do whatever they want. So it's kind of playing into some desires of people. Beautiful shots there from Dustin too, of the city, and I really love those scenes. We had a lot of him looking out the window through the whole movie, and it was sort of like this cool little metaphor of looking out to something. You know, at the beginning of the film, he's looking out to, like, whenever he, after he hires the hitman, he looks out the window, and it's kind of him looking at, you know, he's finally getting to do what he's wanting to do, which is end his own life. And then he's looking out at a certain point to be like, you know, is someone watching me? And then he hides the window in a scene, and then at the end of the film looks out to his self as a child, or his self when he was younger. And it's just kind of these cool little moments of him looking out the window, which I found really awesome. Here's Ex Official. There, he's a cool friend of mine, and an artist, and he told me he would like to be to act and stuff, and so we put him in this part here. Originally, this scene was supposed to be in Joyland, which, awesome enough, we got to film in Joyland for Just Like the Butterfly, but this scene we weren't able to do it. But it works still, I think, in a bowling alley. It's still like a fun scene here with the arcade and the lanes and everything, but it's totally not New York. I mean, I'm not sure, I've actually never went to a bowling alley in New York, but it probably does not look like this. It's definitely South Plains Lanes.
You're lying. I ain't never seen you.
Yeah, this scene was really tough with the loud crashing of the bowling balls and just all that noise that was going on, people talking. We didn't close the place down, which probably would have been the smarter thing, is to come in whenever the place was closed and film this scene, so we didn't have all that noise. But, you know, it's still I think it's still a great scene. This really kind of sweet moment back and forth. A lot of people did ask, is that the girl from The Work? You know, like, because Callie's looked changed in all three scenes that she's in the film. Her look changes so much. I'm like, yeah, we probably should have kept her more consistent with at least like with her hair and things like that, so people would 100% know that was her. I mean, I think it's pretty obvious for most people who are paying attention, but It did. That did come up a couple times whenever people were talking to me about the film. They were like, oh, is that the same girl from... Like, yes, that is. Those Lysol bottles back there really bother me. I can't believe I didn't see that. This is just a chaotic place to shoot in, like with that much noise and that many people. So... This was tough too. I don't know why I thought it would be a good idea. I mean, other than it looking cool, I have no idea why I thought it'd be a good idea to film into an arcade, which I mean, this was just so loud, but it's cool. It's a cool looking scene.
So he basically called me Derek for over a year.
No, he didn't.
Yeah, seriously, I swear.
Oh my God, I hate that guy.
Yeah.
For months, and you were just sitting there by yourself, and
just not that kind of guy.
No. Okay. Well, I can accept that. Well, thanks for hanging out with us today, Derek.
Oh.
Are we leaving yet, Mama?
Yeah, this is a funny scene. Because originally the kid was supposed to be asleep here at the theme park, and as we're filming the scene, Matt was like, "It's so awkward to ask for her number or get her number, with Cody around." And I was like, "Yeah, that is. Yeah, you're right." But I was kind of like trying to push for time, and kind of was, you know, probably not. But yeah, he was right. That is awkward. So we like came up with the idea of putting him in the chair, and it works out great. And then here's a aspect of the film that was in the script. Here we go again. In the script, it was a bigger moment of people on the train staring at him and him kind of freaking out and thinking, who's watching me? And that's Dustin actually right there. And it wasn't supposed to be like people are actually watching him. That's not the hitman, you know. It's just that it was supposed to be a moment of paranoia, and we just didn't have the people, and we didn't have, you know, all these things just didn't pan out like I had hoped. So, you know, we ended up using Dustin for it, and I think it works fine because people I've talked to are like, yeah, it works, but. I think it could have been a lot better achieved, this paranoia, and it would have been cool to build that up over time. But you know, it works. It still works. And we're getting to the point of the film, which is kind of getting to my favorite part of the movie, which is when he gets to Texas. And no surprise there, I love Texas. So. Yeah, and you know, a funny thing about this is Dustin and his wife Leah had just moved into this apartment, so it was kind of perfect. It was empty and kind of what we were going for the movie, which was a man who had just moved to New York and something tragic happened back home, and he just technically never unpacked and moved into his life. He stayed in a limbo, kind of standstill. Here's my tense thriller aspect of the movie right here. I really like this shot here. I really like what Dustin did with the lighting and the color. So cool. The blue little light coming through the window. Of the cool light coming through. Such a cool scene. Such a cool score. That's some stock footage of a plane going over, and then here's some drone shots from Jacob Parson, who came down to Dickens to film this these drone shots, which he did an awesome job with. He ended up crashing the drone, though, and I felt horrible. I felt so bad that he crashed it on. You know, I think he was like pulling it backwards and it hit a power line or something. But yeah, great footage from him. And I've used that footage in another project recently too, so it's come in handy twice. This is actually my great grandparents' house. It's a place that I grew up going to many summers, many spring breaks, Thanksgivings, and spending a lot of time there with my great grandmother. And man, I am so happy that it made it into a movie, and that I get to have this forever. And it's a part of my art because I loved and love them so much. They passed away, my grandmother in 2015 and my grandfather in 2006. And I'm just so glad that this is just on film. And they recently just sold the house as well. So I can never probably step foot in there again. It will never be the same. And, man, I'm just so glad, I made a movie and put it in it. And it's crazy because it was kind of all packed up and was perfect for the movie. But it also has like amazing production value. Like, it just looks great in there. Like the windows and the lights and everything. And I mean, it's just awesome in there. And so, I'm happy and proud that I got to film there for personal reasons, and it just looks awesome. So, win-win. This was probably the toughest scene to edit because there was a couple things going on there. I loved what was happening in this scene cinematically, and the theme and the vibe of it all, I loved it too. So it was really challenging to cut this up because I wanted the audience to feel what it felt like to go home and to, you know, what does it feel like to have, you know, just, I just kind of wanted you to be with Darren here. And, but also I'm making a short film. So it's like these really, and then also the personal side of it is like, I'm looking at my great grandmother's house and it's got a lot of personal things attached to this too. So a lot of tough stuff going on to do it. Cause yeah, I'm making a short film. I should be making this move a lot quicker than it is. But I just couldn't do it. And it's fine. At the end of the day, you live and you learn. And I'm to this day, I'm happy about this stuff. Cause this is my favorite part of the movie. And if you aren't happy with your art, then what are you doing? Spent a lot of time in this house watching VHS tapes with my brother Josh, watching a lot of Superman, Bugs Bunny, Christian music videos that someone recorded on to tape. But yeah, just beautiful work from Dustin and Matt. I mean, he just, it was the end of our filming. We had been filming, I think, I want to say like 5-6 days, and this was the last day of filming. It was all at the house, and Josh was passed out in a room most of the day, just trying to catch up on sleep. And it was, we were all just exhausted. So it was really cool to just come back to just a small little team of people. There was no dialogue really throughout this day, and we were able just to capture some cool things. And I think I remember tearing up on this day because I was like thinking, this is probably the last day I'm going to be in this house. which that wasn't true. I ended up going back a couple more times. But I felt like it was going to be the end. Here's a scene of my nephew and Josh, funny enough, my brother. Yeah, there's my nephew there. And my brother Josh is playing the father. And gosh, that was great looking footage. That was shot years later after the movie was shot. Years, probably like a year and a half later. Yeah, famous hallway right there. That little, if you look closely on the door, there was crayon or pencil markings. Man, this was tough to do because we had, this is like the one of the last things we had to shoot was with Matt with his shaved face and his, in quotes, haircut. I mean, he just tied his hair in buns that was away from the camera. And man, that room. Spend a lot of time in that room. That was the guest room where the kids slept, or us. You could tell right there on if you look at the back of his head, you could tell like the hair is kind of sticking out there, and it looks pretty legit. But that's him tucking his hair to the side and stuff. I think I believe I do have footage of him shaving his face somewhere. I always like this shot, even though it's tilted a little the wrong way, because the shot was actually flipped it upside down, so it's actually the wrong way, technically. And Dustin hated me for rotating it, but I had to, because that's the way I wanted him looking down at the box, not the other way around. That probably literally made no sense to anybody, but whatever. Gosh, what a cool moment. Cutting from the past to the present.
Dispatch, this is Medic 5-4.
We've got an approximately 50-year-old male showing signs incompatible with life.
There's Josh's hand. This was pretty fun to do. I did it with my sister-in-law and my wife. We kind of crafted that scene on the pavement. I loved those sheets flying in the wind. My dad suggested after he watched a cut of the movie that I should end the film here. I'm like, yeah, that's pretty bold to do something like that. I don't think I can do it. It's not a bad idea, but I just couldn't do it. I'm more of a person who's trying to, you know, I do maybe like a dark or depressing or sad movie, and then it ends with hope. And maybe this one doesn't do that as well as I had hoped, but that was the goal. Was to
you weren't out hunting?
To do that. Man, there's just so much going on in this movie with, you know, he's in a hospital now, and cutting to a flashback of the hitman put him in a field, a hunting field, and this scene like was so hard to do, and it got cut up a lot, and because the original part of it was much longer of him getting up, and I ended up just making pushing it all together to like a faster moment. And yeah, I think it works a lot better the way it ended up becoming. I feel like I failed my actor Matt here on this day, and you know, I was pulling Dustin in a wheelchair backwards for this shot, and I should have probably been more present with Matt working with him on the scene instead of, you know, being on a focusing on the camera part of it. And sometimes you just, you know, that's just what happens when you make a film. You gotta put on multiple hats, but I should have been there for such a hard scene to do. I should have been there for him more. And you know, you live, again, you live and you learn, and you learn as a director. And yeah, this scene actually had more to it as well. There was supposed to be a nurse comes in and a doctor comes in, and it's supposed to connect to the beginning of the movie, and that ended up getting cut out just for just keeping in line with the movie. You know, you just, again, just trying to build the perfect film that you can, and I think that just muddied the water too much. Here we are at the end, and the music playing is by my brother and my dad, who ended up writing a song for the movie, which is freaking beautiful. So that's it. That's Four Eyes, the almost feature-length film. No, gosh, such a long short film. At 36 minutes, 31 seconds. Yeah, just thank you guys so much who are fans of this movie. That really means a lot. It was a tough movie to make. It was a good experience, good learning experience for me. And I lived and I grew from this, I hope. And you know, I look back and I wish I had done better in a lot of ways, but you know, you live and you learn. I guess that's where we come to at the end here. But yes, thank you guys so much. If you enjoyed this movie, it really means a lot. I hope you guys keep your eyes out for the next film that I have coming out very soon, called Just Like the Butterfly. Yeah, I'm excited to get that done and released for you guys. So thank you so much, and keep on the lookout for the behind the scenes and Just Like the Butterfly. Catch you guys soon.